Right, hello everybody. Welcome to the last day of our Price of Anarchy workshop. And our last keynote speaker will be Elias Koutsoupias. And actually, he'll be talking about like blockchain mining games.
Thank you, Ross. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here in this beautiful island and with this great group of people. And keeping with tradition, with a trend, I'm not going to talk about the topic in the program. I'm going to talk about something else, about blockchain. So, so what's the connection between this and the Price of Anarchy? In the 1990s, the internet community realized that incentives are very important for the internet. And the problem was the following. The internet was very successful. It had grown by many orders of the growth for magnitude. Agoraphobia keeps coming back. Okay, so internet has grown by many orders of magnitude, but people realized that although the protocol was very stable, there was some existential crisis lying underneath it. And the reason was the following, that incentives did not align with the protocol. So the story goes as follows. Internet started in the 60s, but in the mid-80s, there were serious problems. There was a lot of congestion in the network. At the time, the network was not very large. And then congestion control, a particular algorithm was introduced by Jacobson, and it seemed to solve all the problems. Since that time, until the mid-90s, network increased by many orders. And the protocol seemed to be very stable. It's the same protocol we have today, actually, in the internet. And despite the tremendous growth, the protocol seems to be stable. But the people that were working, developers, and the people that were working on the internet realized that the protocol is not incentive compatible. So, the protocol is a fallen, has a fallen simple idea that nodes in the network keep increasing their rates until they sense congestion. When they sense congestion, they pull back. They reduce their rate by half, by a factor of two. And they keep doing the same thing. So this is not incentive. It's clear it's not incentive compatible. Or at least the first thought is that it's not incentive compatible. Because if I know when I sense congestion, it means that everybody, most of the people around the nodes around me sense congestion, and they are going to reduce their rate. So why should I reduce my rate? In fact, I should. So that seems to be a nice, best response to increase my rate. So this existential crisis brought forward the question about incentives and systems. And that's where Price of Anarchy, this framework, the notion of Price of Anarchy appeared. 10 years later, so so this was captured, this question about the incentives and the internet was captured very well with this question given in a talk by Christos in 2001, in Stock 2001 in Iraq. The question is, since we have this stability, of which game the TCP IP congestion control is then asked to deploy? This was a very influential talk and direction. And it influenced a lot the development of algorithmic game theory. So fast forward from this moment, 10 years, and the birth of Bitcoin occurred. And the two situations bear a lot of similarities. Bitcoin has grown tremendously in the last 10 years by many orders of magnitude, and it's very stable, appears to be very stable. But there are similar incentive vulnerabilities in this protocol. It doesn't appear to be the suggested strategy, it does not appear to be Nash equilibrium. So, so I decided to talk about this, of taking Christos' question and rephrase it for blockchains. Of which game is Nakamoto's protocol, the protocol of Bitcoin, of which game this is the Nash equilibrium. So this is the topic of my talk. So that's what I'm going to try to convey today, some parts of this, trying to answer this question. Okay, but in order to do this, I have to tell you a few things about blockchains. This is a group, most of you know this stuff, but I just need to cover the basis of this protocol, Nakamoto's protocol. This is the protocol that runs the Bitcoin. Bitcoin is the application. And one of the problems of blockchains is that there is a lot of hype. And the question is, are blockchains really useful? So far, there is only one major application of blockchains, Bitcoin, or other cryptocurrencies. Internet in the early 90s had many applications, none of them killer application, email, file transfer, and so on. But in the early 90s, web appeared, the killer application of the internet. And the question is whether blockchains have a similar killer application or other applications, other than cryptocurrencies. Okay, so what's this protocol mean? Underneath that supports Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. So it's a protocol that is executed by anonymous users that can join and leave at any time. Which means that a lot of users can appear or can have different identities and so on. It's a distributed system, it's a peer-to-peer system. And what's the purpose of this system? There is an ideal execution. The ideal execution is that all these users that run the protocol want to create a list. This list is called blockchain. It consists of items, blocks, and in an ideal situation, it looks like a list. So now, here, for my talk, I'm going to label the nodes of the list not with their content, but with the number of the user that created this block, this item. So the last, so the first block here is one, and the last block is two. Goes from left to right. So this is the idea of execution. And what we want from this structure, this distributed structure, we want the following three properties: that everybody can read. If everybody that has access to the peer-to-peer network can read this list, that every user can write in this list. Writing here is only extending the list and adding a block, an item at the end of the list. And the most important property here is consensus, that the users of the system, of this peer-to-peer system, agree, they have consensus about the list. Probably not at the end of the list, the most recent blocks that added to the list because of latencies, but most of the list, the larger part, the original part of the list, would require the users to have consensus. So, so in order to have consensus, in order to achieve this, they have to run it in a peer-to-peer network, and a peer-to-peer network is a distributed system, and there are latencies, so we don't expect the actual execution to be exactly like the ideal execution. So actual execution is going to bit different than the ideal execution. The ideal execution is a list, and the actual execution is a tree. Right? Here, for simplicity, I'm going to use only two users of the network, but keep in mind that this is a network of millions of nodes. So the execution here is the following. They create a list, and at some point, user number two, who is in Argentina, starts creating new blocks on the top, extends the list. Somebody that is in Hanya, so far away, there's latency, takes a fraction, a significant fraction of a section, second, significant fraction of a second for the, just a signal to come here. So this guy here produces, number one, produces blocks. Unaware of the other extension of the list, we have this picture. And there are many many users, and there is a lot of, the latency is significant, then we see branching in a tree. The actual data structure would be a tree. So how Nakamoto, the original proposer of this protocol in 2008, they wrote a paper, we don't know anything about Nakamoto. So they wrote a paper that proposed this protocol, and a few months later wrote the actual code that runs the protocol. So what was the proposal of resolving, of making then the actual execution look like the ideal execution? So the solution has many aspects, but two important aspects of this are the following. Proof of work, which slows down the production of blocks. Proof of work is a great idea and a terrible idea because it wastes a lot of resources for our planet. But mathematically, algorithmically, it's a great idea. One of its use is to slow down the production of blocks. So in order for a user of the system to produce a block, they have first to solve a cryptographic puzzle. And the difficulty of this cryptographic puzzle is adjusted so that the production of blocks is regulated. The original Bitcoin protocol, the expected time to, the ideal time to create the next block is 10 minutes. So they slow down, they make the cryptographic puzzle so hard so that one user can succeed every 10 minutes. This is enough time for this, the network to sync, most of the time to synchronize. But because it's an, this is a random process, no matter how you slow it down, there will be forks. There will be situations where you have a tree instead of a list. So what's the solution in this special case? The solution is the frontier strategy. This is a strategy suggested by the protocol to the users, and the users have to, if they follow it, they have to extend the longest known path. So in this particular example, imagine that both users here know this tree. So not all of them, both of them, if they are going to create a new node, it's going to be at the top of the upper path. It's the longest one. So even if there are, so if users use this, if there are branches, they're going to, they have consensus, so they're going to come and start extend this particular path. The lower part will become a branch, a dead branch of this tree, and we can really ignore it. So that's the idea, that's the ideal execution of the protocol. That was Nakamoto suggested. But this is, we're talking about game theory here, so should have, let's start introducing incentives. So Nakamoto proposed that this system, in order to be successful, should pay its users. So users must get money. And the paper suggested a payment scheme. The payment scheme, more or less, at the beginning, at least of its history, was the following, that every user, let's call it simple payment scheme, every user is paying with amount proportional to the fraction of blocks in the longest chain, the surviving chain. Not the number, but the fraction of blocks, that's important. And in fact, the actual scheme is much more complicated, and I'm going to probably say a few words at the end. And so this was this is the incentives for users to participate. And so we can view them as players, they have a utility. And their utility, of course, is the payment that they get from the protocol minus the effort to solve the cryptographic puzzle and probably do some other minor work for the system. So, and the effort, the underlying assumption for the effort of the users is the following in the original protocol, it's the following that there are users that have different computational power, so they can solve this cryptographic, some of them can solve this cryptographic puzzle very fast, others in a slower manner. So the computational power, the hashing power may vary, but the assumption is that all of them are going to work at full throttle, that everybody will exert maximum computational power. So there is nothing to, it's not part of their strategy. Okay, and what we want, what's the ideal situation, what we want here from this protocol? We want to have at least two properties. It seems this is a social project, and we need people to feel good. So fairness is one of the properties. Fairness means that participants are paid proportionally to their effort, to their participation. And I have to say something about price of anarchy here. So the other thing that we want is that the system has low price of anarchy. Meaning, what's the price of anarchy? It's that the blocks that are the useful blocks over the, all the blocks that were created, that this ratio is as large as possible, close to one. Why this is not exactly one? Because some branches, as we said, become dead, so we don't want, this is a waste here. And frontier, a strategy that says mine, that is create the block only at the end of the longest known chain, has its properties. So Nakamoto wanted frontier to be the strategy that followed by all the users. You have the incentives, and this should be the strategy. So ideally, we want a theorem that says frontier is the only Nash equilibrium of the system. In fact, Nakamoto studied this question. It's a very interesting paper, the original paper, white paper, as they call it in this community, and studied this question, is frontier the Nash equilibrium? Not exactly in these terms, but that was a deadline question. So they considered, Nakamoto considered, another strategy. Let's call it persistent forking. That's my name, it's not the name that Nakamoto gave to this. And it's the following. A user keeps mining its own path. So in this particular example, one, although one may be aware of the of this state of the yeah, so this three, one will keep mining, will keep expanding the lower path in the hope that this will become the longest path at some point. So this persistent forking was studied by Nakamoto, and if you look at the paper, there is no theorem there, but there are computational results that suggest the following theorem that says, and it's a trivial observation, in fact, it says that if you have only two strategies, frontier or persistent forking, frontier meaning try to extend always the longest chain, the longest path, and persistent forking, stay on the path. If you have only these two, then frontier, the best strategy, is a Nash equilibrium. So that was the game theoretic analysis of the original paper. Of course, because for this to be true, no user should have hashing power more than 50%. Because if you have 50%, you can always avoid, create your own path, you always ignore what the others do, and you get 100% of the blocks, the whole payment. Unfortunately, if you look carefully at it, persistent forking is also an asequilibrium. If everybody mines their own path, there is no reason to mine something else. Before I say for the next what happens, this is a historical essential representation of what happened to game theoretic analysis. But there is a serious question about the blue statement at the end that persistent forking is an asequilibrium, because it depends a lot on what are the assumptions about when the game ends. So if we assume that the game goes on forever, then this statement is true. If the game ends at some point, it is not true. And it's easy to see. This is what Nakamoto missed, in fact, at the end, at the last step, you have a reason, even if you have, say, you play persistent forking up to some point, you have a reason at the end to switch to the longest path, because it's hopeless to start with a path that we are far behind. So if you know that the game ends, you should switch to frontier. And by backwards induction, frontier would be the unique Nash equilibrium in this case. So the model, the framework that poses questions is very important. Okay. And so remember, our question is, which game is behind this? Right? So far we have seen two strategies. The game that has the players have two strategies, frontier and persistent forking. But 4 years later, in 2013, Ayer and Siren published a paper where they showed that there are other strategies, and frontier is not always the Nash equilibrium. So they showed the following, that if the expansion of strategies, that a player, a participant, may hide blocks. So if once a user creates a block, they may not show it to the world, they keep it secret for some time, and they release it later for strategic reasons. I'm not going to go into details, but it makes sense. The reason behind it is simple. You are paid according to the fraction of blocks in the longest chain. So when you manage to waste computational power of the others, it's a gain for yourself. So once we keep something secret, the others mine at the wrong part, and you can gain. And if a user has power more than 33% and use this particular strategy proposed by Ayer and Sirer, which is called selfish mining, then you can, if you have more than 33% of the total power, frontier is not the best response. What is a Nash equilibrium is not completely clear, but definitely frontier is not a Nash equilibrium. So this strategy is part of a more general strategy space, let's call it strategic release. Strategic release is when users keep secret, may keep secret their blocks when they create them for some time and release them later so that they manage to waste the computational power of others. Yes?
What happens if somebody has a very long path and reveals it? Do the other players have to pay back the money they got previously?
No. Only imagine that at the end you are paid, so you don't get money as you proceed. In the actual protocol, you get money as you proceed, but you can use the money after 100 blocks, long enough time, so that the system has converged to a single path. So you get money if you produce a block 100 steps back, essentially. So you can assume, so it's simpler to think about when you think about game, that you get the payment at the end. That's not true in for actual protocol, but it's good enough for theoretical analysis. So the theorem that AL and Searle have proved is that surface mining is not the best response to frontier. Surface mining is a better response on frontier for people that have computational power more than 33%. 33% is not one third, it's close to one third. And it's one third that never appears here. It's not a nice answer, but it's a strange number, unknown number, in fact, if you want to completely analyze it. So let's see what we have so far. We have that there are two ways for users, for miners, to deviate from the protocol. The one suggested originally by Nakamoto, which says, don't mine, don't try to extend the longest list, but do something. Try to extend from some other point. And hiding blocks for a while, strategic release. So there are two different ways. So I'm going to say a few results about this, but let's focus first on the idea of Nakamoto. Let's see, Nakamoto suggested that the only available strategy for players is to fork, not to extend the list from the end, but from some other point. Let's ignore that players can hide blocks. So let's assume that it's complete information. So was Nakamoto correct? Let's call these games immediate release. The strategy here for these games is that you have a tree and you decide from which point to extend, where to add a new block. And the answer is not what Nakamoto computed computationally. Because there are other strategies, not persistent forking, but adaptive forking, that do better. So if you have computational power more than 42%, then it's better not to add blocks at the end, but try to fork. And if you fail, if you are behind, you abandon your path and go again at the top and do the same thing. So this is a result with my colleagues from 2016. And the other thing that comes out of this is that frontier is an equilibrium for this class of games when the computational power is less than 42%. Just to say something about this, is 42% large? So this here you have Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies have this huge network. Bitcoin waste this energy proportional to almost all countries, with the majority of countries on Earth. Having 42% of this is huge. But these users come together, they create pools, so this is not unrealistic. For other reasons, people pool their computational resources together and they create large groups that act as one player, so 42%. There were times in history of Bitcoin where there were groups that had power more than 42%. In fact, more than 50%. So, if there are miners that have more than 43%, and this is not a precise number, it comes out of computation, essentially, we don't know precise threshold. So if somebody has more than 43%, will play something different than frontier. Then the question is, unsolved question, what's a nice equilibrium there? Is there pure nice equilibrium? Notice that there can be at most two such players, such huge power, but we don't know what happens in this area. The only thing that we know is that frontier, the suggested strategy, is not a nice equilibrium. So let me try to explain how you get this result. So this is a complete information. Usually, these games that come from Bitcoin and blockchains are stochastic games, incomplete information games. Also, they have randomization. There are a lot of complications. This is a clean game, complicated but clean game. And we're going to analyze it with this question, not an Nash equilibria, but the question of best response by looking at a particular Markov decision process. And there are three states in this Markov decision process. mining states where a person, a user keeps mining at its own, in its own path. There are capitulation where you give up and say, okay, my path is dead, I'm going to go and do something else. Leave my path on my path. And there are winning situations where you are so far ahead that you are certain that you get the money from this block. So if you want to understand this game, here is the game. So it's basically imagine that there are two participants, or there are many participants, and if they, some of them play Frontier, and some other, just one player plays something else. We care about best response here. So we have, suppose that the situation is like this, there are two forks, player one and player two. Player two is ahead. Okay? Player two has nothing to worry about, he's ahead. See, they will keep mining at this point here. What about player one? Suppose that player one has only 45% of the computational power. Less than 50%, 45%. Should player one abandon their path and move to the top path? It seems to be like this, but in order to calculate it, we have to do all, we have to consider the following situation. This here corresponds to this position here, which is 3 and 5, the length of the two paths. And when you are here, you have to decide, what do you know here? With probability 45%, you are going to move to the right. And with probability 55%, up. Once you end up here, you win. Your path is better than the other. Once you end up here, you are so far behind that you capitulate. The question is, what should this gray area be? And in order to calculate it, you need to, this is a Markov, create a Markov decision process, but it's complicated, but it depends. In order to understand this, you have to know how much you are going to gain at this state and this state, and therefore this state and this state, and so on. It's complicated. That's why we don't know the precise answer. This is the theorem that we could prove, is was weaker, that the threshold is not at 42%, but at 38%, at least 38%. But of course you can, this is a Markov decision process, you can make it finite, you run it, and you can be almost certain that 42% is the right answer. So what if you now throw in also strategic release? Not only decide where to mine, but when to release your blocks. Then the threshold of Frontier, when Frontier is, it drops to 34%. Like the surface mining here. Surface mining is not the best strategy, but it's very close to the best strategy in this space. Ayer and Searle almost got it right. So in other words, this says that Bitcoin, the Bitcoin protocol, this kind of protocols, proof of work protocols, are not stable when you have very large players. But 33% is almost safe. Although there are groups that have, there are other incentives here. That's why this question, what is the gate, is complicated. Because imagine that somebody has a computational power that is 40%. Are they going to start doing something else? This will undermine the validity of the protocol, and therefore, the belief of people that this is a good system, and if they are paid by bitcoins, the price of bitcoin will go down, so it's not clear what's the best strategy, even if you have more than 33%. Here we don't consider this, we just consider the incentives as we describe it. But first we formalize the incentives and then we see the results. Okay. So what we have seen so far, we have seen the following, that Nakamoto started the game theoretic analysis, almost, well, exactly game theoretic analysis, but started this, and he suggested persistent forking, then selfish mining came 5 years later, then and 3 years later, two papers appeared that formalized these ideas of where to mine and when to release. And that's not the end of it. There are more strategies out there. Okay. And why they are more studied is because the system is tied with cryptocurrencies. You can do a lot of things if you, and that's the hope of blockchain thinking and cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency is not just one way to grab money from the world. They have some advantages. And one of them is that you can use the money from the cryptocurrency to do things. And one thing that you can do here, if you are a miner, is the following. You can pay forward to improve your chances of getting your block. So I'm going to discuss this. This is a joint work with my group, with Philip here. So imagine the situation that a small miner, you have today, if you create a block in Bitcoin, and you can put this computer in work for this, but it's hopeless. It will create a block, I would say, every 1,000 years or something like that. But imagine that I'm lucky, I just won a lot, and created a block. And there are large miners around, and according to this, it's not a nice equilibrium for them to follow my block. And I'm going I'm afraid that I'm going to lose it. And I don't have any hope to get another one, right? I'm not going to win a lot of lives. It happens. But, so what can I do? I can pay forward the miner that follows me. I can add the incentives of the other miners to follow my block. And this is easy once you have this cryptocurrency. Easy. For example, I create a transaction that I say moves zero money between me and myself, but the person that puts in the block will get a huge transaction fee. This is an implicit way to pay the next miner. Okay, that's not a good idea. As I said it, there are other ways to defeat it, but I hope that you get the idea. So once you have cryptocurrencies and blockchains, you can do a lot of things. One of the things that you can do is pay forward. So here is the idea that imagine that player 2 created a block, right? And if player 2 created a block and has no pay forward, then a miner 1 may create another path. But if player 2 puts enough money down, miner 1 has incentive to follow this, will get the original money plus the pay forward amount. So now the new game is the following. It's a stochastic game. It has three aspects. The players have three aspects. Where to mine, you have these three, and you have to decide where to extend it from. When to rebuild the blocks that you mine, and how is to pay forward for the next guys, or for the guys after them. Smart contracts, you can do more complicated. So that's the set of strategies, and the set of payoffs now is that you are paid proportionally to the number of blocks that you have in the final chain, plus or minus the pay forward amounts. So that's the game, and the idea comes from the gift economy. This is a social, that is, blockchains are social artifacts. So the feel-good situations. So pay forward is one of them. So for example, you can pay forward, this is a black where people pay forward to their friends. So they pay for coffee when their friend comes. It's on the board so they can claim the coffee. There was a movie about pay forward and so on. It's a well-known concept. And you can interpret it here in this blockchain as follows, that what is a pay forward is a fee that I have to give to a miner to include my block in their chain. And so you can completely remove probably the payments, the original payment system, and replace it with a pay forward type system. And this would be very nice if there is such a system for tax where on by design, you want a tree, a dog, in fact, instead of a chain. So blockchain was the original data structure, but people may want to create more complicated data structure. In fact, we want to create more complicated data structure to speed up the situation. And paper may be an idea there. So let's consider the following simple story. You know, we play Frontier, but everybody plays Frontier, but they take and make also forward an amount W, fixed amount W. If everybody does this, then it's the same as before, because you get W from the previous player, you give W to the next one. But you may give an incentive to a very large player that gets W, gives nothing to the next one, because they are not afraid of not being followed. So here is a theorem that says, if you have this, so the situation becomes much more complicated. And the theorems, if you notice, the theorems have some way appeared in a weaker form. That is, the claims are not that this is an Nash equilibrium or this is the situation. We usually discuss just best response. This is the only thing that we can analyze. So let's assume that Frontier, that everybody plays Frontier W. So, which means they follow the longest chain and they pay W to the next one. There is one miner, a large miner, who doesn't follow this protocol, just tries to get as much as possible. So, and assume that this miner does not play strategic release for the moment. Right? And then, pay forward, recover some of the stability for Bitcoin. Notice that so far we discussed strategies where the threshold of stability were going down from 50 to 42 to 33. Now, with pay forward, we move this threshold of stability higher. So you can move it to 50% if you pay enough. And that's what happens. So here is the situation. So at 40, if somebody has 42%, he doesn't have to pay forward. Nobody has to pay forward. Frontier is an asset equilibrium. But once somebody has, say, 44%, the other participants must pay forward 10% of the value of a block. And so on, up to 50%, where they have to give up 80% of the gains. But at least they get something. They get, they win the lotto and get 20% out of it. This is taxed essentially by the large participant. And with this, there is no forking. And this is great for other areas. There is the major danger in cryptocurrencies is double spending. Somebody can use an amount to buy a car, and they use the same amount to buy a computer. Right? That's double spending. And unless, that's why you need consensus, that this will never happen. And forking is creates possibilities for double spending. So this is against forking.
Sorry, a simple question. Once someone has power of more than 50%, they essentially dominate the market, right? They can do whatever they want. So it would be surprising that the W there, when P is equal to 0.5, is not 1?
It is, but what's the answer to that?
So the answer is that to get that, we ran it in a finite model.
Okay. So this is not a long-term game, it's a short-term game. Because you cannot really analyze the infinite horizon game. We analyze only a say, five-step game or something like that. So the game is something. Anyway, you always have a probability of winning.
Okay, nice.
So this has a great, great feature that there is no forking. That is, it's stability for the network to work as a cryptocurrency. And it becomes totally unfair, right? So you have to lose something. In fact, a lot. And let's look at another case where now allow the big miner to also play strategic release, not only to give to this miner the ability to do whatever they want. Then the threshold 33% goes up to something like 38% if you pay more and more and more for the next line. Okay. Okay. So I have seen how this game keeps expanding. We don't know what really happens, right? We know what we observe, a protocol that looks stable, has been stable for a lot of changes. This protocol started with just a few computers, and now, as we said, it's the most energy-consuming computational network on Earth. So we keep analyzing more and more strategies. Actually, we don't know the answers for most of these strategies. We only analyze an aspect of this. Most of this discussion focuses on when frontier is an asset equilibrium, is the best response. What happens beyond that, we don't have no idea. But I'm going to close with keep with a discussion of more strategies. So at the beginning, so all this discussion was assuming that the payment system was the following. Every miner gets an amount proportional to the fraction of the blocks in the chain, in the longest chain. But that's not what happens in actual Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. The amount that you get is fixed amount plus the amount of transactions that are included in the block. So you have a block with a lot of transaction fees, you gain more. And eventually, the plan for Bitcoin is that eventually, in about 100 years, there will be no fixed amount. You are getting all your money from transaction fees. Okay. And a few years ago, a group of people analyzed what will happen in such a situation, where all the money is not fixed per block, but depends on the size of transactions in the block. Then this expands the set of strategies as follows. Which transaction to include in my block and which transactions to leave out? And they proved that frontier is never an asset equilibrium for in this situation. So in the 100 years, frontier is not an asset equilibrium, no matter how weak are the participants. The question is whether pay forward can help in this situation, can put some stability back to the system, as it would with the strategy so far. Finally, let's revisit another assumption we had at the beginning, that participants have their computers, the computational power, the hashing power, which may vary between users, but all of them use maximum computation, very maximum computational power. They exert the maximum possible effort for themselves. So this is the assumption, but very recently, there were two papers in ECE TUC this year that showed that this exerting maximum effort is not an asset equilibrium. It is better to exert some effort, then stay back. The crypto puzzle will become easier, and then you step in, solve the easier crypto puzzle, and so on. So you can gain. So another instability in the system. So the what we see here is that we see gains. So we can view blockchains. I like to see blockchains as distributed systems with incentives. This is the new kid on the block. Distributed systems with incentives is something that is worth of study. It's a complicated topic, but it has great theory and applications, I believe. And the question is still open of which game is Nakamoto's protocol the asset equilibrium. And of course, we're theorists. Can we improve it? Thank you.
Any questions? Yes?
So I have a question. It's sort of a meta question. So I have seen a lot of different models. As you said, what is the right game for the distributed systems and the protocols? And it seems that different models keep popping up, modeling the same thing in different ways. And then sort of my impression is that research is expanding in different directions and also in different conferences, different venues that might not be aware of each other. Is there a way to make this sort of consistent and have a, you know, a consistent literature and where we have identified the right open problems and try working on them? Because it seems to me that we might be, you know, trying to work in, you know, you mentioned some very interesting open problems here, and it seems that people might be working on different models rather than this open problem. So I wonder if there's a way to sort of unify this somehow.
Yeah. A very good question. I have a meta answer to this. I'm not sure that, first of all, that this is the situation. I think that people know more or less what are the models out there. They may not follow them because they are complicated or they are partial answers and they want to do, in an exciting new field, they want to do their own, follow their own direction. But there is a need for having, identifying the fundamental problems out there. I don't think that we have reached that point. But going back to my analogy with the internet, TCP/IP congestion control is still out there, it works. It's a distributed system with incentives, and we don't understand it, and it works. People keep doing research on this. I hope that people will keep doing research on blockchains, even after Bitcoin and the other cryptocurrencies collapse. Or when.
So I like the pay forward idea, and I was wondering, you're kind of paying one step ahead, right? So you're paying the guy who comes right after you. I'm wondering, it's kind of like a revenue sharing, benefit sharing idea. I wonder whether it makes sense to have two hops away where they're kind of different proportions and depending on how people perceive future payments, whether that could even give you different results.
Very good. Yes, in fact, there is a game. You can pay forward the next miner or the. So essentially, what's a pay forward strategy is how much you pay. It's a vector of payments to the next blocks. And then this creates a game between even small miners. Imagine that you have a threat of a very large miner, and you want to pay in order to attract this large miner to continue your blockchain. But you don't want to bear the whole cost. So it's a cost sharing of a fixed amount, but of a amount that comes out of the strategy. So it's complicated, but it's, in fact, you gain by doing this. So we have essentially experiments and some very partial results, theoretical results, that this happens. It's that it's better to pay forward more than one miner, to pay a sequence. And the cryptocurrencies have their underlying language, so you can either you can expand their language or you can use the current one to create these smart contracts. You can do this even in today's systems. You don't have to change the protocols.
More questions?
Does pay forward also work for proof of stake?
Yes, it's the same thing. All this. This is about proof of work, but we never use the fact that it's proof of work, right? But there is no standard system of proof of stake. It's not like Bitcoin, where we know exactly, it's a clean protocol and we analyze it.
Yeah.
For example, Ethereum has a different payment system. And some of the things that I said here do not apply directly to Ethereum, but almost apply to this.
What is proof of stake?
Okay, proof of stake. Proof of work is that you get you create a block with probability proportional to your computational power. Proof of stake, you create a block with probability proportional to your current wealth, your current stake.
Any last question?
Yeah. What about, because there are some incentives that you explain of there are some incentives to create cooperation, create large. Could you predict, or is there any idea of how many players there will be and how much cooperation against the competition?
In this kind of games?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a great question, because all these systems, although they are presented as being a set of users, in fact, they are groups of users. There are incentives for group users to grow together. First of all, because they want to be alive all the time, and if you have a computer, you don't, you can't guarantee that. And there are other reasons you want to decrease the variance of getting payments and so on. So there is a great question: how to organize? How good should be organized of users? How to create cooperation out of this system? Just to run the system, but there is also the meta question. This blockchain is a distributed system with consensus, essentially. And why we need it? Okay, we need it for some people to become rich for getting this from cryptocurrencies, but we don't really need it as a society. We need it as a framework for corporation. So, and it's quite open. In my prediction, it's very hard to predict the future, as you know, of course. But my prediction is that if blockchain is going to have a killer application, it's going to be about collaboration.
Okay, this is the last question.
Is there any cryptocurrencies that actually solve real problems instead of just, puzzles? We could use this to actually do something better for the world.
Yes.
Just actually solving real world problems.
There are a lot of such proposals. None of them, in my opinion, or my knowledge is an appropriate one. But yes, this why waste so much energy? If proof of work is useful, yeah, why not solve actual problems, right? That's a great direction, but there are no nice suggestions so far. At least I haven't seen one.
I think this is our time. Thank you, Elias, very much for a very interesting talk.